Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome everyone back who joined us in the morning and those of you who are joining for the afternoon session on non-tariff measures and market access, how can trade initiatives respond? I'm pleased to have a panel here with us of experts from the industry, from associations, and as well we're joined by Ambassador Daladu from Mauritius, who's going to be starting off the panel with some opening remarks. Then we'll hear from all of our panelists. Two of them have some material as well to share some visual materials on recent research work they have done. Then we'll have a discussion amongst the panel, and we'll then come to you thirdly for questions from the audience. So I'd like to invite all of you to think about what you would like to discuss as we look into non-tariff barriers, as we have a good amount of time allocated for discussion between the panel and the audience. To start off then, I would first introduce Ambassador Daladu, who's going to share some remarks on his perspective on non-tariff measures.
Thank you, Jody. I would first at the outset thank the World Energy Council and the ICSTD for organizing this very important dialogue on driving clean energy technologies through trade policy. And I thank them for providing me the opportunity to be part of this distinguished panel on NTMs and market access for clean energy technologies. Let me start my statement, my presentation with two general remarks. First, as you are aware, the present global trade landscape is fraught with uncertainties. We might face a rollback of trade liberalization, and there may be a shift to bilateral, regional, mega-regional, and bilateral initiative, and this may pose a real challenge to trade rules that conduct global trade. And small players in the global market will have to recast their trade and development strategies. The global market on environmental goods, including clean energy technologies, is estimated to expand to around $3 trillion by 2020. The major players are developed countries and a few emerging economies, but it also offers economic opportunity for developing countries to produce and export clean energy technologies. As you are aware that at the WTO, the typical non-tariff barriers are classified under WTO as imported licensing, standard, testing, labeling, certification, anti-dumping and countervailing measures, export licensing, domestic support, service barriers, and local content regulation. These NTBs are not specific to clean energy technologies, products, and services. They can also be constraining factors for trade in the energy sector. Sorry, they could provide policy space for trade of in the energy sector. Let me now elaborate some of these barriers in the way they are handled in Mauritius. First, we do not have any requirements relating to local content. In fact, investors are free to use imported contents and are not subject to any form of discriminatory treatment. Second, an ambitious reform program is being implemented at the level of customs, including through the implementation of a single window project. And Mauritius is also one among the first countries to have ratified and start implementation of the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement. Third, government procurement procedures are largely in line with WTO government procurement agreement. All bids above 500 million rupees have to be open to international tenders. Fourth, taxation rules have been simplified with an across-the-board rate of 15% applicable to direct and indirect taxation as well to corporation. Fifth, there are no investment restrictions in Mauritius, save for foreign investment cap in the sugar sector. Sixth, licensing regime has been streamlined, and the Board of Investment is in the process of implementing an e-licensing system that enables approval of investment clearances and other permits online with a short period of time. Seven, there is no export prohibition or limitation in general. Eight, the IP regime in Mauritius is in line with the WTO requirements, and the system is now being overhauled by bringing all industrial property protection under one umbrella and by providing for Mauritius to accede to the Patent Cooperation Treaty, the Madrid and the Hague system. We have enlisted the support of WIPO in the elaboration of an intellectual property development plan and an IP legislation which is soon to be finalized and will be tabled in the Parliament. Nine, the judiciary in Mauritius is completely independent and the executive independent of the executive, and the UK Privy Council is the highest court of appeal, which provide an additional guarantee of independence in the judiciary. Tenth, our Energy Efficiency Act provides the framework for product labeling and importation of energy efficiency equipment. We are also addressing the NTMs through our active negotiation in the NTM-related issues within the TISA negotiation, the ITA 1 and ITA 2, and our forthcoming participation in the EGA, and in the various proposals that have been put on table in as potential outcome for MC 11, such as Australian proposal on deregulation on, and the Indian proposal on trade in services, in particular the movement of person mode 4. We see enhanced value that could be brought with participation of MSMEs. The challenge is particularly significant for island developing economies. We are exiguous in size, cannot reap economies of scale as compared to large economies, and this in itself is a major barrier in terms of affordability to transition to low carbon economy and assimilation of technologies. As an island state, Mauritius cannot generate corridors projects such as integrated corridors development in the main continent, Africa. From this vantage, the prospects that could best serve Mauritius and economies outside the continent are the dismantling of barriers to trade in the services component of the clean energy sector. Services comprise over 70% in the diffusion and deployment of clean energy. This will be highly evident with the increasing automation and technological improvements. The servicification component of clean energy trade and participation in GVC segment are areas in which Mauritius would wish to prospect opportunities and capacity. We have been active in, at regional level in COMESA, EAC, and SADC tripartite initiative, where we are addressing non-tariff barriers measures. We are similarly, under COMESA, we have initiated a trade obstacle alert mechanism to address NTMs. Mauritius has developed an initiative called Accelerated Program for Economic Integration under the aegis of the World Bank, and we are sensitizing members in our region on the merits of dismantling of trade barriers. Let me now come with a brief overview on of Mauritius' energy policy and strategies. Mauritius, like many seas, has little known exploitable energy sources. It generates only 22.7% of its energy from renewable resources, of which 70% is from sugarcane bagasse, and the remaining 5.7% is derived from hydro, wind, landfill gas and solar. The government energy policy encourages the use of renewable and clean energy to reduce dependence on imported fossil fuels and decrease greenhouse emission. And it has set its target to increase the share of renewable sources of energy to more than 35% by 2025. The government wants to promote a holistic approach, including the use of clean energy technologies in the following: smart use of marine ocean resources, expansion in solar, wind, and biomass energy production and other renewable energy sources, modernization of national electricity grids through the use of smart technologies, which is a prerequisite to accelerate the uptake of renewable energy, sustainable transportation, including promotion of energy-efficient mass transportation system based on hybrid technologies and cleaner energy sources, climate is smart agriculture, including biofarming, sustainable integrated waste management, including waste to energy, and to leapfrog to low global warming potential refrigerant, building of smart cities, which will be autonomous in renewable energy. The government seeks international competitive bidding for all its power projects and favors joint ventures between local private sector and international firms. The government has also set up very recently a Mauritius Renewable Energy Agency to promote an adoption and the use of renewable energy, create an enabling environment for the development of renewable energy and the increase of share of renewable energy in the national energy mix. Mauritius presented its intended national determined contribution under the UNFCCC Paris Agreement, where we have pledged to develop and improve the energy sector through promotion of clean energy technologies. We have also expressed our interest to join Environmental Goods Agreement. But we are facing challenges, and the challenges for Mauritius is that it is dwarfed in its capacity as a small island developing state. We cannot enjoy economies of scale, and the rationale for engaging in production of clean energy on a massive scale as large economies cannot be practically envisaged. Thus, we will require international support to implement the transition towards low carbon development passed through greater utilization of renewable energy, just like biomass, solar, wind, and other generated energies. I think I'll stop here, and maybe in the course of the discussion, I'll come up again. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador, for sharing these opening remarks with us. I look forward to coming back to you during the Q&A to discuss more about how trade policy may be able to support Mauritius. Yeah, as we proceed with the panel, we'll now hear from Mahesh Sugathan, who is a fellow with ICTSD and will share with us some of his recent research on conformity assessments. Mahesh.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jody. And it's good to be here at the WTO. What I'll do today is basically look at two issues of relevance to trade policy, standards and conformity assessment. My colleague George Kelly, who's also on the panel, is going to give a much more detailed view of what actually consists of what are solar PV standards, you know, what are the standards that are found along the value chain and so on. What I'm going to do today is to touch upon more the link to trade policy and what trade policymakers can do on standards and conformity assessment, and also look at whether there are some lessons in regional trade initiatives like APEC or the TPP, which WTO members could draw upon or maybe multilateralize in the future. So just to give a bit of context, why solar PV panels specifically? I mean, when you look at all the different clean energy technologies, solar PV cells and modules are among the most intensively traded in the world. So looking at, for example, the from 2009 to 2015, what we see is that the imports, the world imports of solar PV modules and LEDs combined rose from about 19.5 billion in 2007 to about 51.2 billion in 2015. Now that's like a big jump of world trade. Now note that I include both modules and LEDs because there's only one tariff classification system which covers both the goods. But if you go at a country level, so looking at the case of China, we see that the Chinese exports of solar PV modules to the rest of the world was about 13 billion in 2015. And when you look at the share of EGA countries, which are 17 countries that are negotiating the Environmental Goods Agreement, that was about 8.4 billion. And the share of non-EGA countries was about $4.6 billion and rising. So you see the small dip in the graph where Chinese exports of solar panels to EGA members fell. Now that represents the anti-dumping duties that was imposed by the EU on Chinese exports. So that just tells you how important some of these non-tariff measures are, like trade remedies. So looking at the trade in solar panels, now when you look at Chinese statistics, we can break down statistics much better because solar panels has its own national classification line in China, right? So one of the suggestions could be for better tracking and for better analysis in the future, maybe the World Customs Organization should think about splitting the whole tariff classification separately for LEDs and separately for solar panels, which would also help in future analysis. Okay. Now, before I come to this slide on lessons from PTAs, I mean, what we found in research at ICTSD was that standards in solar PV modules have not really been a big issue so far. Why is this the case? I mean, one reason is that most countries base their national standards on IEC standards, which are international. There are some additional requirements that are added on to these IEC standards, which are based on justifiable circumstances. I mean, it could be safety, it could be public health, it could be because of differences in national grid codes. Now, the TBT agreement in the WTO does provide exceptions for countries to put in place these additional requirements. So even if the IEC standards are the same, there are national differences that can be justified on the basis of Article 2.4 alone, which says that, you know, if the international standards would be ineffective or inappropriate means for the fulfillment of legitimate objectives pursued, for instance, because of fundamental climatic or geographical factors or fundamental technological problems. So as far as a trade dispute is concerned, there has not been any trade dispute that has arisen at the WTO on solar PV standards, but that doesn't mean that a trade dispute may not arise in the future. Why is that? It's because solar PV technology is growing rapidly. The standardization process is also evolving, and as George will tell you in his presentation, there are a large number of standards that are being developed along the value chain. There are a number of standards which are not fully developed in the services segment of the value chain, right? There are a lot of different standardization organizations. So far, there seems to be an effort among these standard-setting organizations not to duplicate standards or at least to work in coordination with each other so as not to create friction for trade. But again, because of the fact that standard setting is evolving rapidly, I think countries need to be very vigilant and monitor, you know, how standards are developing and how national standards are set, and that they're not set in a manner where these additional differences that are added onto the IEC base are not, you know, are justified. I mean, they are used for legitimate reasons and they're not used for protectionist purposes. The other big issue is in terms of services. Now, in services, you have standards, for example, like qualification and licensing requirements for installers of solar PV panels. There is no set of rules under the GATS which are comparable to the TBT agreement for goods. Now, the question is whether there is a need for a comparable TBT-like agreement in the GATS. I mean, it would... I guess the debate could vary either way because there's already a mandate in the GATS for the domestic party on the domestic working group on domestic regulations to look at developing additional disciplines for things like qualification requirements, technical standards, and licensing requirements. So there's still a work in progress. There has been a set of disciplines developed under the GATS for the accountancy sector. Now, the argument is whether, I mean, should we think about a new set of disciplines similar to the accounting sector that should be developed specifically for clean energy? I mean, there may be a need, there may not be a need, but it's something worth considering. I mean, if it really helps the cause of freer trade. The other big issue is conformity assessment. Now, while standards have not been a big issue so far, at least from the literature that we've seen, there have been instances of conformity assessment systems causing problems. So there needs to be overall better streamlining procedures in conformity assessment. One of the big issues that have been identified are multiple testing requirements. So there is a need to avoid multiple testing requirements for destination countries in cases where those multiple testing requirements are not justified. So in case it is possible to have one single harmonized test for the PV module, and if there is no need for an additional testing, there might be some need for additional testing where there, for example, differences is national codes, safety issues that might warrant that additional testing. But if there is no need, it would be much better to have one single test for all countries. There are also instances where, for example, the way that the conformity assessment is carried out could have a de facto trade restrictive effect, even if they're based on legitimate objectives such as safety or traceability. Now, one of the big issues is in the TBT committee, there was the issue raised about the Korean certification for thin film solar panels. Now, what happened was that the Korean national standard was based on the IEC solar standard, but the fact is that the Korean, the conformity assessment body would only certify one type of thin film panels, which was the amorphous silicon thin film panels. Why didn't they certify the other panels? They didn't certify that because there was a lot of uncertainty about the cadmium content of those panels. Now, the US and the EU raised this issue in the TBT committee, and the Koreans have also responded that they've commissioned a study looking into the safety aspects, and that the other panels would also be, you know, made eligible soon. So one of the ways that the WTO already has a built-in system through discussions in the TBT committee to resolve some of these conformity assessment issues as they arise. So in a way that one could say that there is a system that has been functioning more or less pretty smoothly. But what else is required? I mean, there is also a need to look at what is happening in regional trade agreements, bilateral trade agreements, on conformity assessment issues, on making standardization processes much smoother. And a couple of good examples come to mind. I mean, from the goods side, we have the EU-Singapore FTA, where we have a chapter which is specifically on non-tariff barriers to renewable energy. And under that chapter, Article 4.7d provides a freedom of operators to select the conformity assessment body. So if there are more than one conformity assessment bodies that would provide certification, importers are free to choose from whichever conformity assessment body that they like. There's also a possibility for consultations on sectoral initiatives. Article 7.5.3 of the agreement also provides for the EU and Singapore to both accept each other's declaration of conformity and test reports, which includes products under Chapter 84, as well as specific renewable energy products like wind turbines and solar PV modules. The other example, which is interesting on the services side, is found in the Trans-Pacific Partnership, where there is a specific reference to the mutual recognition of professional qualifications for architects and engineers that builds on previous APEC initiatives like the APEC engineer and the APEC architect registers. So the APEC is a good example of a laboratory where new ideas are tested, and then you have like more formal trade agreements building on that or taking a page out of that and also referring to APEC. So these are all good examples that could be drawn upon. Now, this has happened in a bilateral and regional context, and the issue is whether some lessons from this could also be multilateralized at the WTO, you know, on things like mutual conformity assessment, mutual recognition, et cetera. The other interesting thing that APEC has done is that APEC, in its 2011 Honolulu Declaration, says that there is a need for economies to promote regulatory coherence and cooperation in areas affecting environmental goods, including by better aligning approaches to standards and conformance. APEC has also set up a subcommittee on standards conformance, which is under the APEC Committee on Trade and Investment. Now, one of the initiatives under the SCSC was the Solar Technology Standards and Conformance Initiative, and three recommendations that came out from that was very useful in guiding further work. One was commitment to greater participation and use of international standards, while recognizing that local conditions, such as insulation codes, grid design, building construction, etc., may require limited national differences. Secondly, cooperation on the development of a strong technical basis for all test procedures, including those used as a basis for product certification, labeling, and safety standards. And C, greater recognition of certification bodies' audits of production facilities to decrease the needs for multiple audits of one facility. So the SCSC was set up as a committee specifically under the APEC initiative, but then why not have something similar which goes beyond APEC, you know, which involves all the big traders of solar PV technologies, including blocks like the EU, for example. So finally, I would come to like the need for a mutual recognition arrangement as a possible solution to deal with issues of conformity assessment. We already have examples of mutual recognition agreements existing for sectors like automobiles, medical equipment, et cetera. Now, the question is, why couldn't there be a mutual recognition agreement for clean technologies? That could, for example, enable countries to build on regulatory cooperative arrangements. You know, that could gradually progress from information exchange and trust building to mutual recognition of accreditation systems and testing procedures to test results, and finally, even perhaps mutual recognition of technical regulations. So maybe having something which I would call like a trade facilitation green. We already have a trade facilitation agreement which has been heralded as revolutionary. Why not have something like a trade facilitation green, just for green products and for clean energy products, that could look to identify all these different issues and get countries to start working on them and have a solution within a couple of years. I think that would do a lot to help in the scale-up of clean energy worldwide. So I'd like to end with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mahesh. We'll now turn to our guest panelist by video, George Kelly, who's the president of Sunset Technologies. George, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Wonderful. We'll turn over to you.
Okay. So in addition to Sunset Technology, which is my own consulting firm, my main job is actually as secretary of the IEC Technical Committee 82, which handles solar PV. And I'm also been quite engaged in the past 3 or 4 years with the other technical committees that handle wind and marine energy systems. But for this study, the way we started was just looking at kind of the history of standards in the solar energy sector and see where they've taken us so far. So this first slide here is developed by a colleague of mine, Jae-yoon Ho from Korea, and she recently got her PhD in this area. So she's done a lot of the basic research in the background and interviewing experts. But what this chart shows is that for generally any industry, this is the case. Excuse me while I mute that other phone. Sorry about that. So on the left side of the graph, you see sort of when the technology is brand new, basically being discovered. We have a lot of work on basic standards for measurement and testing of the device to, for example, determine how much current or voltage a solar cell is producing. That mostly happened in the 70s and 80s. A lot of that basic work was done by IEC as well as by ASTM. We'll then move into kind of the market building or confidence building stage, where we started working on standards for the finished product, the PV module and the inverter, the conversion equipment, that would assure long life, high quality, reliability, so that customers of these products could be confident that they were gonna get what they intended. This probably went on from the mid 80s through the late 90s, that most of those standards were written and developed. And they cover not only the performance of the product, but safety issues as well. And then in the last 15 years or so, we've seen a really explosive growth in PV, and that's sort of reflected by the chart there on that parabolic curve. And as we get into this period of wider deployment and acceptance, we have to start looking at standards for the interface between the PV or the energy equipment and the rest of the electric grid and the rest of the equipment and devices that people use in their lives. So most of the work, I would say, in the last 4 to 5 years has been around these kind of system integration standards, which also include the installation procedures, the monitoring of the output, comparing actual energy production versus forecasts, and that's where most of the work has been lately. If you could go to the next slide, please, Sylvia. This is a chart of the 6 standards development organizations that have done by far the majority of the work in the PV solar industry. And I have worked as a committee member on all of these organizations. By far, IEC is my most high volume kind of work, and that is the largest and most influential committee among this group. There are about 350 people involved in the IEC PV committee. They are appointed by their national committees. There are, I believe, 49 countries right now participating in this committee. And, there are a few, such as US, Germany, China, Japan, Korea, that have a lot of experts working in the committee. And then there are many other countries that just have one or two experts that participate. But generally, we meet twice a year and in person, and then in between have a lot of this kind of video meeting to actually write the standards. And the scope of the IEC committee is very broad, covers everything from the basic measurement techniques up to and including the safety and installation of complete large systems. ASTM, which also I was the chairman of that committee for a while, they did a lot more of the early work and recently have not been as active as IEC. They're organized a little bit differently. All these organizations have similar processes for developing consensus among experts, but the way they organize it is a little different. In IEC, it goes by country. In ASTM, it's individuals, and each person gets a vote, regardless of what country or what company you're from. Next on the list there is the Semiconductor Equipment Manufacturers Institute, SEMI. These are primarily your manufacturing companies. Right now, this committee is extremely active in China and in Taiwan. And they are focused a lot on sort of the raw materials and the production line equipment, communication protocols between the various machines in a factory. And we at IEC are working very closely with SEMI to avoid what Mahesh mentioned earlier, any kind of duplication or overlap in the standards that would cause confusion and difficulty for the industry. Underwriters Laboratories, actually all the other 3 on this list are rather specialized organizations. So UL is very focused on safety requirements, and UL listing is required in North America, the US and Canada, but not in too many other parts of the world. The International Code Council, ICC, is specifically looking at building codes and fire codes and how these solar panels get integrated into a building. And then the IEEE is more focusing on the grid connection aspects. How do we make sure that the energy coming in from the renewables isn't going to cause unforeseen problems in the rest of the grid that's operating on traditional sources? Can we have the next, please? So this brings us to the conformity assessment part of the discussion, which Mahesh touched on earlier. And this is something that was developed, actually started about 5 years, 6 years ago in the Wind Turbine Committee. But now we have a system called IECRE, which is conformity assessment for renewable energy. We have structured this system in sort of a modular fashion. So you see on your screen there, the three different columns are wind energy, marine energy, and PV solar. These each have their own subcommittee that manages the details in that industry, but the overall system is run under the same common rules by IEC. Now you also see on this chart that horizontally there's a green box and a red box there, and that kind of defines the split between the things you can assess and test in the factory, like PV modules, wind turbine gearboxes, things like that. And then there are certain things that you can't check until they're actually installed, the installation and the operation of the system in the field has to be done in the field. There's no way I can certify from a factory test that your solar modules are going to work if they're not installed properly. So this lower box on the chart is where most of the work has been going on lately, and probably where most of the potential for wider deployment and acceptance in new markets is related to that aspect of the conformance to standards. That's all I have right now. I'll be happy to answer questions as they come up.
Thank you very much, George. Moving forward, I'd like to introduce our fourth panelist. Timothy Richards is Executive Chairman of the World Energy Council's Task Force on Rules of Trade and also a Senior Executive for Government Affairs and Policy with General Electric. Tim, I'll turn over to you for comments.
Thank you, Jody, and good afternoon, everybody. As Jody said, I've had the privilege of leading the World Energy Council's group that's been looking at trade and energy issues, and we have covered a lot of ground since 2008 when we started. We've done a general review of all sorts of trade issues in the energy space, and then we did a much more detailed study about a year and a half ago on tariff barriers, out of which we came up with our own list of environmentally friendly energy products that we recommended to the governments that are now, in fact, first it went to APEC and then subsequently has gone to the group of governments that are negotiating the environmental goods agreement. And then most recently, in the summer of 2016, we came out with a report on non-tariff measures. And all of this together is really a very strong indication of how important it is for the energy sector to begin to be covered more systematically in the WTO world and in the trade rules world more broadly. So I wanted to talk a little bit about, just a tiny bit about actual issues in the non-tariff measure world, but I won't go into a lot more detail because you've had some great examples already of the kind of things that can exist. But so first I'll just say a few words about that, and then I want to talk about the existing rules and then get to the subject of this panel and talk about how can the trade initiatives respond to issues that are out there. And we have a few ideas from the WEC, and I've got a couple of things I want to put out that are newer ideas that are more to be thought-provoking and see what people think. So in terms of non-tariff measures, we produced this report in the summer of 2016. There are copies of it outside if you'd like to pick up. This is just a four-page version of it, but you can pick up your four-page version. We've identified a dozen different categories of non-tariff measures and compiled some examples of case studies where these have actually caused issues for trade in energy products. So probably the biggest amongst these are local content requirements. You heard a lot about that in the earlier panel. But I would say local content requirements are one of the biggest issues for the energy sector writ large. So it's not just in the solar PV area. It's really quite broadly applied all around the world. And there have been a couple of trade cases, both the one that was referenced with regard to Canada, the one that was referenced with regard to India. But there's a lot more measures out there that are not yet subject to any kind of trade action and which remain in effect. Secondly, the area of standards and conformity assessment, which you've just heard quite a bit about. The only thing I would add there, I think this is another area where there are quite a few rules, but there's not necessarily application completely in a non-discriminatory way yet. In fact, this week there will be a U.S. trade delegation coming to meet with GCC countries, specifically to talk about having the GCC become more open, not just to IEC standards, but also to North American standards for electrical products. And this is something that has been occurring over the last few years as Saudi Arabia and other countries have moved increasingly to only applying IEC standards, which means products that were already designed in Saudi may not be may no longer be allowed to enter the country. So when you need replacement parts, that could be a very serious issue and obviously has a trade effect. A third category, which you also heard a little bit about earlier today, is process and production methods, where Ambassador Fried spoke about the Canadian case of oil sands and EU export or EU bans on the importation of product made with the production methods being used in the oil sands. That, too, is a very big issue and one which has not really been fully settled, so one to keep a very close eye on. A couple that have not been discussed in as much detail, one is subsidies. Now, people have touched on subsidies a bit, but there are a huge range of subsidies in the energy sector. Let's start with that. The subsidies can be applied to promote certain technologies that are actively being seen as a benefit to a country. So there are quite a few forms of subsidies for new and cleaner energy, whether it's in the form of higher feed-in tariffs or whether it's direct payments to manufacturers to develop capability. There's also a lot of residual subsidies for fossil fuels, and those are usually in place more to cushion the impact on consumers of paying the price of fossil fuels. And so, and those are just two of the predominant types of subsidies that you see, but they have very different effects. And one thing that you're seeing a lot of right now is as country budgets, whether in countries that are oil-producing nations or other countries, as country budgets have become tighter almost everywhere in the world, the ability to maintain that kind of subsidy system has become more limited. And so you're seeing a phasing out of a lot of those subsidies, especially fossil fuel subsidies. Now, this is recognized by countries like the UAE, where I live, that this has a couple of benefits. First of all, it's better for the budget, so that's an easy one. But secondly, everyone now is really quite openly talking about the fact that only when you begin to bring prices up to a market level do you actually have any incentives for efficiency and economizing on the use of those fossil fuels. So I actually think that now may be a good time to begin to address some of these types of subsidies, because in a sense it's going with the flow as there is a strong international tendency to move away from some of those subsidies. And finally, customs procedures. Customs procedures were addressed in the trade facilitation agreement here in the WTO. They are not specific, really, to the energy sector, but they're very important for the energy sector, particularly, as Christoph Frey mentioned, if 50% of total capital investment in the world is in the energy sector, that is a tremendous amount of capital equipment that's moving around the world. And the ability to get that through customs in a timely way is extremely important. And when you can't, and as my company, GE, occasionally experiences, if you have an aircraft engine or a gas turbine that's a multi-million dollar piece of equipment sitting in customs for a month or more than a month, the carrying cost on that is really quite substantial. So put all this together, and you do come to the realization that the idea that non-tariff measures are twice as have twice the effect as tariff measures on trade is pretty easily visible. So let's talk about what should be done. First of all, many of the things that we covered in our report and which have been discussed here are in some ways already covered by WTO agreements, and many of them are also covered by bilateral and regional trade agreements. But as we've also discussed, all too often, even though they are possibly covered, they really haven't been, those rules have not been implemented or have not been enforced. So you have, like, local content is one of the best examples. You can cite on the fingers of one hand how many cases have actually been brought, but you don't need to poke in very deep to find dozens or even hundreds of local content requirements that exist around the world, and which probably would be vulnerable to WTO cases if somebody chose to bring them. Same thing is true, technical barriers to trade. The rules apply in the energy sector, but I suspect that there are more cases in the energy sector where traditional use of a single set of standards continues rather than allowing multiple sets of internationally recognized standards. So what do we do? Seems to me that the international community has to pursue a multi-pronged approach. The fact is, not very much is moving on the multilateral level, and there's not a lot of evidence that anything is going to move soon on the multilateral level. Nonetheless, preserving the Environmental Goods Agreement in the form that it reached in December at the time that negotiations were called off is extremely important, because a tremendous amount of progress was made there, and many of those who were negotiating the agreement think that it was quite close to being able to have been concluded. It's important to maintain the EGA, because when things do become more opportune for negotiating that agreement, it can also serve, not only are there benefits to removing those tariffs, but there are also benefits in terms of serving as a hub onto which you can put other pieces. And the other pieces can obviously include additional products. They can include more countries, because it's a plurilateral agreement. Making it truly multilateral would be beneficial. And finally, you can include non-tariff measures and services. And these don't have to all happen at once. These can be bolted on at various stages once you have that EGA in place. The second thing to do is to continue to pursue bilateral and regional agreements. And finding like-minded countries who are ready to enter into an agreement can be very valuable. And we just saw some slides from Mahesh about what's been done in bilateral and regional agreements, particularly what's been done by some of the EU FTAs and what has been done in APEC. And those are things which should continue, because it's really important. Not only are there benefits to the parties to those agreements, but it also codifies ideas about how to approach these issues that other countries can take into account as well, and ultimately may become part of a multilateral system. And then it seems to me that if these rules in the WTO are going to mean anything, one way to improve the system would, in fact, be to see a little more litigation. And Jody and I were joking earlier, that may seem like a very American comment, but but in fact, the use of the dispute settlement mechanism would certainly stir things up, and it might not result in exactly the same. It might not result in what everybody would expect, which is, you know, sort of firm application of the existing rules. But it might also result in a little bit more of a dialogue about what do we want the rules to be, and trying to reach a point where there's real consensus that that could then be codified. And finally, I think in these times when the existing institutions are having a hard time moving because of populist pressures all over the world, this is a time when organizations like the ICSID and like the World Energy Council have the opportunity to serve as places where ideas are brought together and consensus could be sought, real debates could be had, and some kinds of ideas can be promoted by these organizations that then governments can come and pick up, and where the non-governmental organizations could actually create the advance wave, essentially, to put things in place that can later be turned into actual trade agreements by governments. And I think that's something Christoph and I were talking about earlier. It's something that I think needs to be done, and I would particularly, it needs to be done in depth. You can't just do that with, you know, a single half-day conference. It's going to require working groups that go after it for a long time and talk about individual issues. But I think that's exactly what's needed, and I think doing that would have tremendous benefits. So I'll stop there, Jody.
Thank you very much, Tim. In the spirit of discussion, since you just concluded, I'd like to go to the other panelists first and ask you, before I exercise the moderator's privilege to ask questions, how would you like to respond to this broad framework that Tim has just shared with us, one where we may need to take a multi-pronged approach to addressing local content regulations, to addressing standards and application of those standards across world regions, building beyond the EGA, and lastly, the potentially controversial but certainly thought-provoking question, should the dispute resolution mechanism be used far more to address the elephant in the room of widespread local content requirements, despite the fact that they're non-compliant? First, I'd like to open up to the panel, George, Mahesh, Ambassador Deladu, if you'd like to comment back on any of those topics before we move forward.
Yes, I'd like to say something. I think that the IEC RE system that I brought up is trying to do just exactly that, that we're essentially seeking voluntary compliance through pressure by the market stakeholders, the customers, the bankers, the people who are paying for these technologies, rather than relying on laws and trade agreements. But of course, they also have their role. And I totally agree with the multi-pronged approach that Tim was describing.
George, if I can ask a follow-on to your comment.
Yep.
I'd noted after reading your paper that the IECRE today has 15 countries that have joined, and it seems like there's a broad benefit for all nations to be involved in this discussion through their national committees. Why have others not joined? What is the outlook for increased collaboration using the IEC as a vehicle for renewable energy standards?
I think the major reason we don't have more participants yet is that it is a brand new system, and we are really just reaching the end of writing the rules of how the system will work. Meanwhile, the countries that are participating have to pay dues to IEC. So if you're a country that may not have a lot of cash for dues, and you're not, you know, strongly involved in setting up these rules, it kind of makes sense to sit back and wait until the system is really functioning, which we hope will be this year. And then we expect more countries to sign in. In the older conformity assessment systems that deal with sort of traditional electrical products, appliances, telephones, things like that, generally there are you know, 80 or 100 countries participating in those established systems. So that's our target. But we are right now the infant of the IEC systems.
Thank you for sharing that clarification. I wanted to now come back to Ambassador Daladu regarding your thoughts on the multi-pronged strategy that Tim had tossed out to the panel.
I think I'll concur fully with the view that we need a, I fully concur with the view that we need a multi-pronged approach.
Sorry. It's okay now.
Yeah. I repeat, I just say that I really concur with the view that we should need a multi-pronged approach because it is a new issue for in order to get the more advantage of the renewable energy. It should have gone to many into many directions. Mm-hmm. Now, coming back to the local content, what you say that this is an issue which is the biggest issue in the energy sector. And I think we have to see that the local content requirements should not be binding, because majority of developing countries, they may not have local technologies to offer. And Mauritius is one among them, to a certain extent, if I can say. And if we put local content requirement to use local technologies, then we limit the scope for countries to be exposed to more advanced technologies elsewhere, and therefore limits also the possibility for technology transfer and assimilation of more performing technologies.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Mahesh, would you like to add a contribution?
Yes, thank you. I think I would broadly agree with the multi-pronged approach. But I mean, I would also sort of raise the possibility of replicating some of the existing best practices like APEC at the multilateral level. I mean, APEC, one of the great things with APEC is that it provides a voluntary environment where countries can discuss without being constrained by the negotiating setting. So often what we've seen is that when WTO members get constrained in a negotiating setting, very little moves. So maybe why not try to replicate the sort of the laboratory kind of scenario where, you know, countries can freely discuss ideas and options, and then if the time is right, if everybody feels it's right, that can then move to the next step. So I think that's a great thing that APEC does. The thing with dispute settlement is that, well, ideally it would be better not to get to the dispute stage. And also, I wanted to also just raise the question, what do you feel about the value of bilateral discussions? I mean, you mentioned the delegation, the US delegation visiting GCC. What could those kind of bilateral discussions, I mean, could that actually resolve some of these issues which private sector is facing? I mean, mm-hmm. That could also be one of the ways.
Yeah, Mahesh, I actually think that's definitely part of the process. In fact, the ideal is you never actually go into a WTO dispute settlement case. The ideal is that there's a conversation, people say we're concerned about this, and then some compromise is reached. And let me also be clear that in the work of the World Energy Council on local content requirements in particular, we're very careful to recognize that those exist for very logical reasons. The policy reasons for them are usually to try to create employment, to try to diversify economies, and that's completely understandable. The problem is if you try to build everything everywhere because you have these requirements that are increasingly applied, it becomes truly impossible. And if you're also trying to bring down costs and optimize your entire supply chain, it also becomes very difficult. So it's not that we don't recognize the legitimacy of the objective. It's just that the mechanisms that are used have to be carefully thought out in order to make it work.
So I'd like to take that then to the other panelists. I understand the World Energy Council has coined this phrase, the energy trilemma, which is energy security, energy equity, and sustainability.
Yes.
How do you see this in the context of local content requirements? And I'd go first to you, Tim, and then George, if you'd like to make a comment on this, we'll come to you on the screen and then to Ambassador Daladu and Mahesh. How does this trilemma manifest itself in local content, building on the discussion we've had previously?
Yeah, it's actually the amazing thing about trade liberalization in general helps you achieve all three aspects of the trilemma, helps optimize all three aspects of the trilemma, because you're basically taking cost out of the system. Cost that is government imposed and is really only a tax. And whether the tax is in a non-tariff form or whether it's in a tariff form, it has the same effect. So in our perspective, we think of this as one of those no-lose kind of moves that helps you with all three of those things. It helps make energy less expensive and therefore easier to make it more available. It makes the cleaner energy technologies more available, and so it helps with sustainability and just brings costs down in general.
Thank you. Thank you, Tim. George, if we turn over to you, how do you see the local content challenge in the context of security of supply, of energy equity, and also of sustainability?
I think I'm not so much of an expert on the security or those aspects, but I can tell you from personal experience that the local content, as Tim mentioned, typically those requirements are in place to help employment in a given country. And I used to work in a PV module factory here in the US. And as many of you may know, in the last 8 years, all the manufacturing has moved out of the US with very few exceptions. And at first that was considered a big problem and there were all kinds of reactions and moves to put tariffs in place and so forth to protect against these imported products. But in the end, what has really happened in the U.S. is that we have created a lot more jobs installing and maintaining this equipment than we ever had manufacturing it. So the thing, I guess my point would be that when you're considering local content, it's not only the hardware and particularly the specialized hardware that's used for these systems, but also a lot of the local, you can't import the construction and the operation of these things. You have to have local people who are there for the next 20 or 30 years operating these systems. And that, I think, needs to be considered when you're balancing local versus imported content.
Thank you very much for sharing your personal anecdote and this perspective from your experience in the U.S. I don't know if either of you would like to come in and add additional comments.
No, I just have maybe a question on the local contents, how it can promote sustainable industrialization.
The local content requirements.
If it promotes sustainable industrialization, then it creates jobs, it creates security, and it creates access to energy. So this is something I think we can think about.
I'll take a moderator's privilege and respond to this as when I'm not here visiting with ICTSD, I spend a lot of time speaking out against local content requirements. One could say it's a hobby. One of the major challenges is that it raises the costs. Because if you want to build 10,000 widgets, that widget will have a certain cost. But then if you go build a billion widgets, the widget will have a lower cost. And every time a local content is created, with the exception of perhaps one, two, three extremely large economies, effectively the consumer is forced to buy a widget made in a factory that makes many fewer widgets every year. So the cost is much higher. Then you fast forward to today, to 2017, and we have a situation where robots are making widgets. So I look at it from the question of, does it matter if the robot is in my country or yours? If we're both WTO members, we both have robots. Perhaps the power plant that's generating the electricity for those robots will benefit, and some employees in quality control will benefit, but longer term, the consumers suffer. I think, Tim, you phrased it quite correctly when you called it a form of tax. Mm-hmm. It may not have the word tax applied to it, but in terms of the function on the market, that is...
It's a form of tax.
...the result.
If I could just add a comment to this. But I think, Mr. Ambassador, you've hit on a really important point, which is there's a big difference between local content requirements and localization. So localizing, because it makes sense and can actually build a competitive, sustainable, long-term industry, is a great thing. And so countries that create incentives to make it attractive to invest in the sector then allow companies and everyone else to assess all of the factors and make a decision about whether they want to make that investment or not. And if they do, it's probably going to be a good investment. By contrast, when somebody's forced to invest, usually their incentives are to do as little of it as possible. So that leads to the wrong kind of incentive structure. So we really need to focus, when we talk about what we really should be talking about is what's needed to create sustainable long-term localization. That really, then you create the infrastructure that goes with it, and you create jobs that are going to be there for a while, and that's all the good things. And that's really where policy makers ought to be focusing.
Yeah, I think the long-term localization of jobs, particularly in services, you had referenced mm-hmm. a very high level of services in your introductory remarks, and I think that those services jobs are in the end, as you'd started us off noting, services that can't be exported, and they'll always be local, maintaining that equipment and installing the equipment and writing the contracts for the equipment, the accounting work for the equipment in the long term.
Research and development.
Yep, and research and development as well. I see Mahesh raising his hand. Please, Mahesh.
Yeah, I mean, just one point about the automation aspect as well. I mean, I would think that installation and services part of the value chain may be less subject to the risk of automation as compared to manufacturing. I mean, that's also another thing to keep in mind.
Right.
In terms of our time, we have 15 minutes before the close of the session, so I'd like to turn over to questions from you in the room, and we'll take a few questions and then come back to the panel for final closing remarks in the last few minutes. If we have any questions from the room. So while you're thinking about it, I'll address another question to the panel. We've talked about a number of non-tariff barriers on the panel today, and we certainly have focused on local content, as that's one that recurringly is coming up as a great challenge for industry. I wanted to come back to the panel and ask about the other non-tariff barriers. Other than local content and standards, which we have addressed, what about other barriers, barriers to services, barriers relating to intellectual property rights or trade remedies? Where do you see the other challenges that are being faced by the industry today that are blocking our progress toward the Paris commitments? Please, Ambassador.
Now, in spite of other NTMs or NTBs, I think we can see that there are some invisible or unidentified conditionality that are attached to exports for recipient country to procure CET from donor countries. This discriminates against other competitive exporters. And here we need to have transparency and clear transaction for clean energy products. We have also heard that the production process and method have not yet been resolved. Okay, but question may be made arise of and different interpretation can be also come up on the table of how really clean is a clean energy product. And how we can establish that. At some stages in production process, conventional energy is used, which has its usual level of gas emission. This can also be challenged unless there are no constraining rules with respect to production process and method. Regarding IP rules, I think we should ensure that the clean technology transfer is not unduly impacted by IP rules. IP rules may be a stumbling block and should be addressed through flexibility provisions.
Mahesh or George online, would you like to make a comment on NTBs you feel have been underrepresented thus far?
Well, I mean, there is this issue of trade remedies, anti-dumping, and countervailing duties. And I mean, there is the anti-dumping agreement and so on, but I don't know if there is any move towards actually giving some predictability against the use of anti-dumping measures, because obviously what we've seen is that the trade volumes affected are very high. So could something be done to give some predictability against the use of anti-dumping measures, at least for clean energy or keeping the clean energy and climate objective in mind? That's
So I was just scanning the list of non-tariff measures which we had covered in our report, and actually most of them have been addressed at least lightly and sometimes in some depth. But a couple of them I wanted to highlight. One that we haven't talked about at all is investment restrictions. And in the energy sector, very frequently, because energy is often considered a strategic natural resource or a strategic national asset, very often you'll have restrictions on the ability of a non-national company to invest in the sector. And this is one of those things which, this has been changing. So increasingly, there are countries allowing a lot of investment into the sector. But we just pointed it out as one thing where it is, in fact, it's a restriction on investment, but it can also result in restrictions on services. So trade and services can be affected. And then the last one we talked about was export prohibitions. And the best example of this is the United States, where there are still on the books laws that predict that require licensing for the export of natural gas and oil. Now, the Trump administration very well may change those, and the Obama administration was already granting those licenses. But it is an area where, for a very long time, the U.S. was not exporting natural gas or oil, and that's going to change. That's going to have a big effect on the marketplace as well.
If I can ask a follow-on, in terms of the committee work on the investment restrictions, had they developed a recommended next step process in terms of addressing this on a plurilateral basis?
Basically, we didn't get into a lot of recommendations on investment restrictions because the WEC has a pretty broad membership. People come from a wide variety of perspectives on this. So we took note of it as something that does have trade effects without really providing recommendations as to the action.
Okay. Are there any other questions from the floor? I guess you're all looking forward to coffee. Then I will come back to the panel then for our closing remarks, coming first to Ambassador Daladu, then Mahesh. We'll come to you, George, and then back to you, Tim. Ambassador, please.
Now, we spoke about, subsidies, okay? But I think fossil fuel subsidies have to be phased out at a certain given time. Otherwise, they are a barrier to scaling up of clean energy. And secondly, I'd like to mention that I did refer in my statement that at regional level, we have a trade obstacle alert mechanism in which we are trying to use for our trade in the region. And I think a similar mechanism should be envisaged to scale up trade in the CET. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. I think looking ahead, the momentum that we had so far for the EGA, that has to be continued. I mean, the EGA has run into difficulties, but as Tim pointed out, it provides a great template for addressing a lot of these issues for clean energy. And you know, even if it takes time, WTO members could actually build in different issues into the EGA, and it could be like a dynamic agreement as well. So that would be sort of my concluding thought, that we could look at bilateral agreements, voluntary agreements, APEC type of initiatives. But at the end of the day, businesses need predictability, and that predictability can only be provided by a binding framework of rules. And ultimately, that should be the long-term goal. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahesh. Coming to you, George, online.
Yes, I'd just like to take my last opportunity here to remind everyone on the panel and in the room that the reason we're talking about clean energy technologies is, you know, there's a really serious problem with dirty energy technologies in the past that have affected our climate and potentially you know, will cause disastrous problems in the future if we don't convert to a clean energy economy. So I think we're doing what we can with standards. I encourage all of you to do your part through trade agreements or whatever tools you have available. But keep in mind that this is a really serious topic that we must address, and we must address now.
Thank you, George. I couldn't concur more. Okay. Tim, please.
So I think we're living in a time of populism when many of the core principles on which the WTO has been created are coming under threat and being brought into question. And the fact that the EGA has not been able to be brought to a conclusion is one example of that. In fact, as a fact, trade liberalization does actually create jobs, does actually create more activity, does actually allow you to develop a sector or an area that is subject to that trade liberalization. And that's what we need to keep focusing on and keep looking for all avenues to move the ball in the right direction. And that's why I think the multi-pronged approach is particularly important at a time when there is no clear avenue that's the one way that's going to work. And if we get those multi-prongs going, we can always bring it back together and focus on one or the other piece of that that is starting to be successful. And I'd say the clean energy sector is one which absolutely is perfectly set up for this multi-prong approach, and that's what we need to do. And those of us in non-governmental roles have a role to play here as well, not just the governments.
Thank you, Tim. In conclusion, I'd like to thank all four of the panelists for their thought-provoking and challenging contributions that they've made today, as well as for the new research that was presented. And as we close and move into the coffee break, I'd like to say, just as a final comment, the reason this discussion is so important is because we're trying collectively, following Paris, to limit temperature increases to only 2 degrees Celsius, not 4 degrees. We just concluded the warmest year on record in the history of recorded temperature, and the year before was the second warmest year. So this work is work that has a very important timeline, and I think the multi-pronged approach that was brought up today with contributions from the first panel and the second, both offer opportunity, despite the hold that the EGA had experienced at the end of last year, for many countries to move together, whether it's bilaterally, whether it's voluntarily, whether it's moving regionally, or ultimately plurilaterally, so that we can come together and address these very real challenges that we have with our climate. So thank you all, and I'd like to invite you to join me in thanking the panel.